the devil, no, not today. The devil, no, not today. No, 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 not ever again. Jesus, let the devil, no, not today. Not today, not today. I'll sing the night into the morning. I'll sing the
thank God for the daylight. I spent a long time in the dark, felt good saying goodbye. Waking up to a brand new heart. And if you're sleeping like I used to be, in a grave that holds you tight, there's a savior calling.
The joy of seeing a child open the boxes for the first time is just, it's incredible.
We are so excited. Many of the children receive shoe boxes for the first time in their life.
We pray that these boxes will be used to bring a lot of happiness and joy, but more importantly, the gospel to each heart, all these little children around the world.
No greater need and no greater time than right now for us to go out and serve boldly. This is what these shoe boxes are all about, to go out and to bring a hope of Jesus Christ around the world.
I'm just so amazed at what God does each and every year. This is an opportunity to impact the lives of millions of children, just like you've seen. But we need more boxes for next year. Every box is an opportunity for us to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. So thank you, and God bless each and every one.
Student activities here at the WBU, right? I am so excited to be at chapel this morning with you all and ready to start us off and start it off right. Couple of announcements before we just set sail on chapel today. First off, Operation Christmas Child. Remember, we want you to get those boxes together. This is an opportunity to really love people around us, to send those all over the world. And so that's something that's super easy that you and a friend or a pal or a girlfriend or a boyfriend, I don't care. That's something you can do. Remember to drop those off in the Brown Family Conference Center. That is the little chapel in between Jimmy Dean and the University Center, all right? So drop them off there. We need those in a couple of weeks. Past that, Boo Bash is happening Thursday. Yay, it'll be fun. That is tomorrow. Costume contest, dance in Pete's Place beginning at 9:00. And then, today is the last day for spooky bags. You can purchase those outside of the calf today. Thank you, good job. All right. Anyways, we are going to get started. Guys, it is an honor to worship as the Wayland family, as the family of God. And so if you would, stand with me, and we're going to pray together, and we're going to get this party started, okay? Father God, we come before you grateful. We come before you grateful that we are able to worship you. We do not have to go between anyone. We do not have to turn to someone else. Father, to be able to communicate with you. Father, and even past that, you are present with us in this room. And so, Father, as we enter into your house, Father, as we worship you, God, I pray that it is a beautiful fragrance. Father, that it is a worthy sacrifice. God, the truth is that there are a lot of us that bring some things into this room that no one knows. We all have different stories.
We all have different things, Father, that just take up our mind. So, Lord, over the next hour, over our next time, God, I just ask that we are able to turn to you. Father, to give you the honor, to give you the glory, to give you the praise that you deserve, but to also lay down our lives intentionally. Father, we give you the glory. Father, we pray all of this in your mighty name, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Your power and your presence So faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ. Romans 10:17.
Call to me, and I will answer you, and will tell you great and hidden things that you have not known. Jeremiah 33:3.
When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth, for he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. John 16:13.
For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul, of spirit, of joint and marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. Hebrews 4:12.
God of creation,
there at the start, before the beginning of time, to the dark and fleshed out the wonder of light. And as you speak, 100 billion galaxies are born in the vapor of your breath, the planet. If the stars were made to worship, so will I. I can see your heart and everything you've made. Every burning star, a signal fire of praise. If creation sings your praises, so will I. So will I. If the mountains bow in reverence, so will I. If the oceans roar your greatness, so will I. For if everything exists to lift you high, so will I. If the wind goes where you send it, so where you lost your life so I could find it here. If you left the grave behind you, so will I. I can see your heart and everything you've done. Every part designed in a work of art called love. If you gladly chose surrender, so will I. I can see your heart a billion different ways. Every precious one, a child you died to. You gave your life to love them, so will I. Like you would again 100 billion times. But what measure could amount to your desire? You're the one who never leaves the one.
Dear Lord Jesus, we just come to you today, Lord, and we just thank you for all that you are, Lord. We thank you that you are the one that never leaves anyone behind, and that you love each and every one of us, and that you care about every single little detail that goes on in our life, Lord Jesus, the ones that nobody knows about. And we pray that we just encounter your love always, every single day, so that we're able to spread it and share it around, Lord. But we just love you, and we just give you this day, and we thank you for everything, and amen.
My name's Dr. Randy Rogers. It's a privilege to be with you today. I represent my family, gladly celebrate my wife, Lita, and my children. I'm glad that we're able to work in this area as a family. I'm glad to be able to teach and minister to you. I'm glad to represent the place where I'm an interim pastor right now, Stonebridge Baptist Fellowship. I love those guys. Glad to be serving there. Glad to represent School of Christian Studies. And my peeps over there, I love you guys. Thank you. And of course, my Wayland family. It's good to see you guys. So glad you're here. It's awesome to be in the house of the Lord today. Hey, let me tell you something. I believe God speaks. And I believe he speaks in real time. I believe he can dial up your name in your ears and your heart right now. And I believe he can interject into your life no matter where you are. I believe God speaks. In other words, the day when I walked into my house, and one of the experiences, there have been several times when I can say beyond a shadow of a doubt, God has spoken into my life using his voice, using his words. Things that I would not have thought of, God has interjected into my life. And one of those times, I was walking down the sidewalk at the front door. I had papers in both hands. I was a little agitated, but also kind of excited. Things were happening in my life. I was thrilled. And of course, at 16, everything's either really high or really low. So here I'm a teenager. I'm walking to the front door. I've got all this going on in my hands. I open the door, walk inside, and the phone's sitting right there. And of course, it's not just any kind of phone. It's one of those old phones stuck to the wall attached. If it's not plugged in, it doesn't work, all right? Anybody had the privilege of using one of those? So, again, as I'm looking at the phone, there it is. It rings the minute I walk in the door, and I think, that's the phone. It's ringing. I guess I should answer it. So I walk over there, papers in both hands. I set them down. I pick up the phone. I say hello, and I think,
God does speak. And you may be thinking, what? All right, let's back it up a little bit. When I was 16, I needed to get a job for the summer. I had a car that my parents had paid for. Wish I'd had a job before they got that, but still, I had one. And now I needed to put gas in it, and I needed to be able to go places. I got to pay for that, right? So it's like, all right, great, you got a car. Now you got to get a job. So I'm thinking, where would I like to work? And there's all sorts of places for teenagers to work. But man, back in the day, the sporting goods store was the place to be. They paid better than everyone else, and you got comped on stuff. So, you know, baseball stuff, sports stuff, sneakerheads, anybody. I mean, just all that stuff. Air Jordans, you look at them as classics. I saw them for the first time in the box when they arrived at the store, right? Great place to work. But here's the deal. Everybody wanted to work there. I went and applied. And again, thinking that's what I wanted to do, I thought, I'm going to apply there, and it's going to be the place. So I applied, went back home. Nobody called the day after. Nobody called the day after that. 1 week in, nobody called. 2 weeks in, nobody called. We're working into week three now. No one's called. I don't have a job. I'm not going anywhere. My life is, you know, I'm 16. My life is crashing around me. And so I had a conversation with God. God, I have a need. You know I have a need. I need a job. What are we going to do about this? You know, silence. Anybody else, right? Nothing from God. I said, so God, I've got to have this. And then in that moment, this happens. God says, where have you applied for a job? That's all you got to say, God? How about, yes, I'll give you the one you want. How about Oshman's is going to call today? That's what I wanted to hear. But instead, the conversation was, where have you applied? It's an odd thing for God to say, but I found out something in that moment. When God speaks, he speaks into the moment and the relationship. It's not just, hey, God, speak to me and tell me what I want to hear. It's not just, hey, God, speak to me and show me what I want. But in the moment, it was conversation. Hey, God, I need a job. Hey, Randy, where have you applied? You know what rolled through my mind at that minute? It's all the places I hadn't applied. McDonald's, you know, Kroger, Safeway, all these grocery stores. I mean, let's be honest, I'd rather sell shoes than have to do that back-breaking work back in the back where you got to put stuff on a pallet and move it around the store. By the way, I didn't realize you did that at Oshman's too. I was 16. I didn't know a whole lot at the time. But I wanted to do the sporting goods. He said, no, you've got to apply at these other places. And in that moment, I had to come to terms with God's voice. Because when you want God to speak and you want to hear what's going on, sometimes God is going to give you information that's going to help you grow, but it's not what you want to hear. And there it was in my moment, as I heard God say, what have you jobs have you applied for? I had to humble myself. And I went out on Monday morning, and I grabbed an application from McDonald's, and I grabbed an application from Safeway, the grocery store, and I grabbed one from Kroger, the grocery store. And I had like six different applications from places that I thought I was too good for. And I realized in that moment when God spoke to me that I had to humble myself and listen to what God was driving for in my life and not what I thought would be best for me. And I came home with these six pieces of paper, and I opened that front door, and that phone rang, and I've got these papers all in my hand, and I'm ready to fill them out. I'm just going to go for it. I need a job. I've got to have one. I picked up the phone. It was Oshman Sporting Goods saying they had two guys reassigned over the weekend. They needed help. Can I come in tomorrow for an interview? And by Friday, I was doing the job that I desired. I know God speaks. I know it's in the conversation. From the moment we had the conversation of him questioning me to the moment where he actually met the need that I had, I know that God can come through. And one of those times happened in a phone conversation. Let me ask you this. Why does it matter that God speaks? Some of you, maybe you're thinking, that's great for you, Dr. Rogers. Of course, you've heard God speak, but I don't know that everybody can. And maybe you're thinking, I've never heard God speak. Well, let me tell you why it matters that God speaks. First of all, God's voice is power. When you go through that Old Testament class and you meet that creation story, you realize that it was the voice of God that spoke everything into existence. And the voice of God that brings everything together. The voice of God matters because it's power. And I would love to hear that. I would love to be connected to the one who created the universe and has dialed up everything around me, knows how it works, and in fact is making a plan for it. It's also important because God's voice is guidance. It's a lamp in the darkness of my path. It shows me the way to go. And so hearing God's voice is crucial to knowing that I'm going in the right path in my life, to know that I'm following in decisions. And by the way, I make wrong decisions. The guidance helps me with the course correction. It's also important because God's voice is a comfort. I mean, there are times when I look back and I wonder, how did I get here? What am I doing? And I can turn around and look back at all the points where I know God has spoken. And in every time that God has voiced a correction, his pleasure, a question for me, when I see that happen, I can see that the power of God has been displayed, and I can know with great comfort that God is walking with me. Hey, it matters that God speaks. By the way, for those of you who are really trying to know what God's will is for your life, you're trying to hear what he might have to say, be aware of this. God's voice is not manipulative. It's not coercive. It's not damaging. It's not harmful. And for all of us, it is not a selfish voice. It's not a voice that leads to brokenness and destruction. God's voice is one that speaks towards power and healing, renewal and strength and guidance for us. So some of you may be pursuing God, and you may think, well, I might be hearing some spiritual voices in my life. I want you to understand God's voice is one that matters, but it calls us to a place of growth and healing and unity, not one of self-destruction. So as we consider God's voice today, we're going to be looking in 1 Samuel chapter 3. Now, tell me, I've got a picture coming up here on the slide. Tell me if you've ever felt this way before. All right? Maybe you've been in a big crowded store, a street fair where you felt separated from the ones you love. This was me. This is how I felt when I was probably about 8 years old in the amusement park at Disney World. And I'm walking around with my parents, and I've got some, you know, there's the Small World little music thing, the hypnotizing song that plays over and over again to my right, and then there's some other things to the left. And as I'm walking by there, the music just, you know, it hypnotizes you like, oh. The next thing I know, I look up and my mom and my dad and my sister are gone, and it's just me. And I would have longed for any point in that, any time there, for something familiar to be said. But I thought, man, I'm lost, and I don't know anybody, and I'm in trouble here. And sometimes I feel like when I'm listening for God's voice, it can be hard to hear in this world the voice of God. We're surrounded by noise, we're surrounded by activity, but we long for something familiar, something comforting, something that will guide us. And instead, all we get is background music, and we get people selling us things rather than really trying to help us. And when we look in 1 Samuel chapter 3, I think we're going to find here that we come across a time where our hero, Samuel, finds himself in a similar situation. 1 Samuel chapter 3 verse 1 says this. Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord in the presence of Eli. Now Eli was the high priest, and the word of the Lord was rare in those days. There was no frequent vision. There was no frequent word of God. So understand, back in Samuel's day, that Eli the high priest was doing his work, and they were coming in and they were trying to get things done every day for God, and they were serving him regularly. And we find that Samuel, as a young boy, who, by the way, he's got his own backstory, miracle birth, should never have lived. God gave him as a gift to his mother Hannah. And when he was born, Hannah gave him back to God. And from his very, very youngest of ages, maybe 4 or 5, he began to be tutored and growing up in the house of Eli to be a priest someday. And he had ears to hear the word of God. And he had a sensitivity for it as well. And when God spoke, Samuel began to connect. Samuel began to hear. But we find here under the leadership of Eli that in those days, hearing was difficult. Hearing was tough. There's a lot of things going on. Wars, rumors of wars happening. As we consider the difficulty that they were facing, we find that even the leaders of Israel were focused on their own gain with little thought for the provision of the people. The priests were stealing people's sacrifices, and they were stealing from God as well. And in addition, these priests were actually forcing young women to give themselves to the priest, and they were forced into sexual slavery in the house of God. Does anybody find that to be wrong and inappropriate? Let me tell you something. The voice of God had already spoken about these circumstances. God had already told his people through the law, don't do these things. But no one was listening. And in this moment, as the listening became weaker and the voice of God was heard less frequently, we find that God steps in. We can see a description of the circumstances in 1 Samuel chapter 2. Got a couple verses here, I think, that speak to that. Eli's sons were wicked men. They had no regard for the Lord or for priests' share of the sacrifices. from the people. In other words, when they were doing the sacrifices, they would reach in and grab the best parts that were supposed to be reserved for God himself, and they would steal from God and from the people. But notice this, Eli was very old. He heard about everything his sons were doing to all of Israel and how they were sleeping with the women who served at the entrance to the tent of meeting. Not only were they stealing from God, not only were they stealing from those who sacrificed, but they stole the daughters of the families that lived around them. They were corrupt, they were unjust, they were not listening for God's voice, and they had lost an ear for what God might say. There wasn't much hearing going on. But that doesn't mean God wasn't speaking. It means they weren't listening. I feel like I'm in a place in this kind of a world today where there's a lot of noise going on. Studies show that every 8 to 15 seconds, we are inviting new voices into our head through our phones and through our laptops. Every 8 to 15 seconds, we've shifted to a new idea, a new thought, a new authority in our lives. Some of them make us laugh. Some of them make us cry. Some of them give us money, and a lot of them take our money. The truth is, we live in a very distracted state where we'll give our ears to anyone. And at that point, it's hard to recognize who might be right and who might be wrong. We're listening to anything and everything. The truth is, we live in a world that wants to attract us. They want to make contact with us and put us in a place where they can distract us until we get into a contract with them. And basically buy everything they have to sell us. And then all we do is react to them. And these are the conversations, these are the people we listen to, these are the ones we give our souls to every day. They entertain us, they inform us, and we feel good about life. But I want to tell you something, while they attract, while they distract, and while we react, they exact a price from us. We're letting them own us. When God speaks, he wants to interact. He wants to have a conversation. He wants to relate. He wants to sit down, have his voice heard, and he wants to hear your voice as well. And it's not something where he's selling. It's something where he's giving. Giving life. Giving hope. Giving guidance. So as we consider again what God might do for us, we have clamoring voices all around. And it's to a point where we're driven to distraction and unable to do things that are right. Hey, I read a story that really kind of made me question my whole existence the other day. There was a subway train in a major city. And on the subway train, full of people, one of the cars in the back of the train, and towards the back of the thing, there were two people that seemed to be wrestling. And all of a sudden, a woman began to cry out, telling the guy that was with her to stop, get off of me, leave me alone. And the front of the subway train was full of people. And now there are cameras set up. And so there are people who are able to monitor this. And one of the folks who worked for the subway train looked at the camera, saw this event happening, dialed 911, told the officer at the next stop, there's a rape taking place on the train. And an officer got on because someone looked at the video and called. But there were people with phones and iPads able to contact the police on the car itself. And none of them looked, none of them dialed at all. They refused to hear the cry of one broken. They refused to hear the voice of the oppressed. They were too busy diving into what their voices were saying on their devices that when the real world happened around them, they couldn't hear that God was calling for justice, and none of them responded. As I look at Samuel, 1 Samuel chapter 3, I find that we are in a similar state here. Think about this statement for just a minute with me. Why is it that we would rather be reporters and distorters of the truth for personal gain rather than supporters and exporters of justice for a better society? God is speaking about redeeming the world. God is crying out with power for change. God's voice is all around us resonating with truth, and yet we have become a society that would rather stare down and take a video or take a picture of an event and let everybody know what someone else has done rather than to dive in with real life and bring truth and justice into the midst of it. We've become a society of watchers. But God's voice is calling us to be a society that engages. Eli had been relegated to the sideline, but we find in 1 Samuel chapter 3 that God's voice is still speaking, and he has designs for something else. 1 Samuel 3 says this: at that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, he was lying down in his familiar place. And the lamp of God had not yet gone out. And I just, let me say right here, I got good news for you today. If it feels dark around you sometimes, the lamp of God is still burning. The light of God is still alive. There is still hope in every circumstance. For even the misdeeds of man cannot put out the holiness and righteousness of the power of God. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord where the ark of God was. I want to make this observation that within that area, again, we're talking about hearing God. There's something curious about the physics of sound. That, you know, if you could take a sound wave, and if you put it, the experiment goes like this. You've got a dome. You put a clock in the dome, and then through suction, you can take the air out of that and remove all air, all oxygen, all mediums for resonance within that. The alarm clock can go off, and there will be no sound. You will not hear anything come through the glass because you have to have oxygen. You have to have air. You have to have the solid material. You have to have some kind of medium to take the vibrations of the sound. And the truth is, a lot of us live in a life where the air has been sucked out of us. There's many ways that the energy has left the room, has left the building. We can't hear in part because there's nothing around us to resonate anymore. In fact, the area around us has become dead and our ears have dimmed as well. But we notice here that it takes air to keep the lamp going, and I just want to remind you that where the Spirit of God is, where the breath of God is, where the Word of God is, there's life, and He can restore the opportunity for you to hear. It's not hopeless with God breathing into the area where we are. So as we consider again 1 Samuel chapter 3 verses 2 through 3, what is happening in this time, note again that Eli's eyes are dim. He's reclining in his own place, but Samuel is in where the temple of the Lord is. He's where the ark of God is. The ark is God's throne. Know this, Eli and Samuel both had access to God's throne room. And in this moment, it's Samuel, a young child, with the presence of God and the flame of God burning, in just a small moment, pulled away from everything else in the world, not distracted by so many things, that in this moment he can hear what God is saying. I want to jump to verse 8. 1 Samuel chapter 3, verse 8 says this: the Lord called Samuel, and he called him again. He had called him once, he called him twice, and he called Samuel again for the third time. And he arose. And Samuel went to Eli and said, here I am, for you called me. And Eli, in that moment, perceived that the Lord had called him. See, Eli told him twice already, I didn't call you. I'm not talking to you. I'm an old man. I'm just trying to sleep. But Samuel kept hearing the voice. Notice here that in this moment, Eli perceived that the Lord, God himself, had called the boy. God still speaks. In verse 9, Eli said to Samuel, go, lie back down, and if he calls you, say to him, speak, Lord, for your servant hears. So Samuel went, and he laid down in his place, and the Lord came and stood, calling as at other times, Samuel, Samuel. And then Samuel said, speak, for your servant hears. Let me tell you something. There is hope that we can hear the voice of God. How can Samuel hear God's voice? Here's a couple things that Samuel does in our story that makes the voice ready for him that I encourage you to consider doing, or maybe you to begin to move forward. Again, God is speaking all around us, but we can be very distracted to the point that our heads are down and our lives are so consumed with our 15 seconds of internet conversations that we have that we don't look up and realize there are real people all around us in need of contact. This is what Samuel did, I think, right. First of all, notice he's in the presence of God. He knows where the throne room of God is. He's gone to find God, and he's resting there in the moment. God apparently doesn't always come to him and say, do this or do that. He's given him clear instructions on a daily routine. But in the moment when he speaks, Samuel's ready to hear it. He's hanging with the right people. Eli's heard God's voice before. Samuel said, hey, you've heard. I want to know as well. Teach me how you do it. He's letting his core people and his family, they've pushed him to be in this place to listen. Do your friends, do your family, do the people you hang out with, the most important people with you, do they encourage you to go deeper? Do they encourage you to listen to God's word? Or do they pull you away from it? Are they just as distracting as others? Create a group around you that pushes you into hearing what God has to say, not away from it. And notice also, he's in the presence of God, and he may not know everything. Samuel doesn't know everything. He's young. He's just learning. But he does know this, that he's in the right place, and he's got the right channel. He can zoom it in and hear what God has to say. Again, he's in the presence of God, and he has Eli there to help him. Eli's eyes are dim, but Eli's experienced it. This experience can help him understand. And notice one other thing. He perceives God's voice as an interaction for relationship, not a distraction from his own agenda. Well, this is so important. I think this is where many of us miss the fact that God's voice is here and God's voice is present. Because we get the wrong idea that God's voice is here to affirm everything I do, to tell me I'm such a great person, and God's voice is going to show the world that my way is the best way. That's not what God's voice is designed to do. If that's your goal in life, to build your kingdom, to do what you want to do and to be successful all in your own name, God's voice will be very difficult to hear because you've claimed you don't need it, and quite frankly, you've shown that you don't really understand it. God's voice is calling us into relationship. Come sit with me. Come walk with me. God is moving all around us, and his voice is one that wants to interact with us, not simply tell you, oh, you're doing great. Just keep going the way you're going. Because if we do that, if we do it in sin, we're lost and gone forever. God's voice calls into the brokenness of our life and tries to pull us out into healing. Samuel does the right thing in perceiving that God's voice is an interaction, not simply a distraction. And I think he's right to understand that this is not going to be just a 15-second conversation, that this is something that's going to last a lot longer. He's in the presence of God, he's hanging out with the right people, and he perceives God's voice as the right voice and the right path to go, not something interrupting his agenda. Finally, not only does he interact with it, but he listens and responds. He heard the cry. No one else is available. No one else is listening. Samuel heard it and reacted. And he called for more when his soul was awakened to the possibility that the almighty power of God wanted to interact with him. God, I'm here. I know you're the creator. I know you do new things. Here's your servant. By the way, if you call yourself a servant, you're admitting that the voice that's spoken is the boss. And you're willing to pursue that. If we're going to hear God's voice, we're going to have to put ourselves in positions where we can set aside the distractions, tune out those who are trying to squeeze more money and information out of us, and go to the one who gives life rather than takes it. As you consider how God speaks into this moment and his voice is very real and how Samuel begins to interact with it, notice that the voice of God brings a very powerful message to Samuel. 1 Samuel 3:11 through 12 talk about the message that Samuel is going to be given. This is not what I would call an affirming message. This is not a message that says everything is okay. But this is the voice of God that needed to be heard. And this is the one Samuel who heard it. In a world of distractions, in a world of brokenness, in a world where the politicians and the religious both abused the weak, in a world that was in need of justice, in a world that was in need of change and transformation, this is the word of the Lord. This is what the young man Samuel was told, and this would be his agenda moving forward. This was his growth moment. The Lord said to Samuel, "Behold, I'm about to do two things in Israel, at which the two ears of everyone that hears it," now it says will tingle, but have you ever had that high-pitched squeal, you know, stress headache, that kind of feedback in your own ears where you're like, man, I don't like that, that's uncomfortable. That's the idea here. This is not, oh man, I got this ear itch. This is, wow, I wish I hadn't heard that. Please take your fingernails off the chalkboard. On that day, I will fulfill against Eli all that I have spoken concerning his house from beginning to end. Okay. Man, the voice of God is crying out for reform. The voice of God is calling out for justice. And there's some of you here that are here today, and you wonder, is God speaking? Look, the voice of God was in the midst of that woman's cry for help on the train. Everybody else turned their back. We don't need to hear the word of God. We've got our own entertainment. But entertainment wasn't what was needed. Someone needed to rise up on behalf of the broken. Someone needed to make the call for help to come. Someone needs to listen and hear God crying out on behalf of the broken and the hurting. This is a call to action. It's not, for me, it's a call to personal devotion, but a personal devotion that leads to change in me and change in my world. And you see these issues all around us. We need a change in politics. We need a change in the way we relate to one another, both as male and female. We need a change in the way that we relate to one another in terms of our own ethnicities. We need more development and change in the way that we address things religiously and politically. We need to set the conflict aside because God brings a voice that's still and quiet in the moment. Remember, think of how he talked. Think of how he spoke to Samuel. Samuel was laying down. It was quiet. It was conversational. Samuel, he knew his name. It was very personal. He called to him, "Come to me, walk with me," in a very personal way. And folks, he's willing to do that. He's doing it now. He knows your name. He's calling to you in a very personal way. Come, follow me. Because when the noises gets louder, and when the big voice of God comes and he drops a flood, let me tell you something, the personal conversations are over when the flood comes, and that voice of God is very big and very destructive. That's when it's too late for change. Samuel gets a chance here in this moment when he hears God's voice. Samuel gets the chance to hear it in conversation. Samuel responds in the quiet voice, and they grow together in relationship. When he brings the big guns later, Eli and his sons, who did not hear the quiet voice, will not get the chance to respond in conversation. They will hear judgment. God speaks. Oftentimes, we want it in the big, boisterous way. We want the megaphone. The truth is, he speaks quietly in conversation to most of us. And if we don't respond to that when it gets louder, it may be too late to have that personal conversation. I want to encourage you today, pause. See what God is saying. Respond to him. See what his voice says. Respond to the quiet things, the calling of your name, so that we might grow in justice and see a world changed. Thank you, Father, for the opportunity to do your work. Thank you for your word. We pray that it would speak today. God, I pray your word is living in this moment, that these students know you are real and that you do know their names and will walk with them. I pray, Father, that each one of us in here will pause for a minute today and ask you, where are you, God? Will you speak to me? That we will bring our needs to you and wait with anticipation at how you will respond. Thank you for your call to salvation. Thank you for your call to justice. And thank you, God, for offering personal relationship to us. We rejoice in your voice. Speak to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. You're dismissed.
you